Dear friends, good morning. Welcome, welcome. As we gather today for our worship service, for the service of the Lord's Day, Aaron is going to get us started with some prelude music today. Here's Aaron. Friends, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning. Word of welcome to all of you to the Kirk of Kansas City on this beautiful but chilly Lord's Day. Glad that you are here with me, whether you're joining us online or on site. If you're worshiping here with us in the sanctuary, please take a moment to find and fill out our ritual of friendship pads. It's one way that we can make note of your presence today. It's a good way for you to send in prayer requests, any other information you'd like us to have. Thank you for your help with that task today. Leave it as you exit the sanctuary in the offering plates that are for that purpose, as well as our offering today. Those are there in the lobby as you exit the sanctuary. After worship, everyone is invited for a time of fellowship outside on the patio. Coffee hour today is hosted by our deacons. We thank you, Kirk Deacons, for that. We look forward to seeing everyone then. For those of you who are joining us online, a word of welcome to you as well. If you're new around here, my name is Chad Herring. I'm the pastor of the Kirk. We are a Christian community seeking to follow God in the way of Jesus Christ and part of the Presbyterian Church USA. You can learn more about our church at our website, kckirk.org. Find us also on social media. Look for the Kirk of KC. Our contact information is there on the screen. If you want to get a hold of me, my contact information, how you can get a hold of me, is there as well. Our motto around here is community-minded, loving, and serving. Help us build community online by using our chat rooms on Zoom or on Facebook, whether you're watching live or watching a little bit later today. Let us know where you are, what's going on in your neck of the woods. You can also, if you're watching us live, submit prayer requests, and we'll include all of those today in our common prayer together just a bit later in our service. Today is our final Sunday in our three-week stewardship emphasis here at the Kirk. And even though we talk about God's generosity and God's gifts each and every week, we pause in November to talk about stewardship so we can lift up how each of us can contribute to the ministry and mission of this congregation. Whether you're a member or a regular visitor or an occasional watcher online, we hope that you will support the work that we are doing in this place. Our theme for stewardship this year has been renewing our strength. It's an idea that comes to us from the prophet Isaiah. Today, we look ahead beyond the horizon of this year, beyond the horizon of the pandemic, and we trust that God is leading us into God's hopeful future. As we follow where God is leading with our individual contributions, we will each find our strength renewed as a community of faith. Last week, we distributed pledge packets. If you haven't received one, there are a few extra copies out on a table in the lobby out by the tree there on the wall. Or you can check out the links that are on our website, kckirk.org. Today is Pledge Dedication Sunday, where many of us are ready to dedicate our pledges for the coming year. We ask for these pledges because they're an important way that we can build and responsibly plan for a budget next year. If you are a regular pledger, thank you very much for your ongoing support. If you do not regularly pledge, we appreciate so much each and every gift that you're able to make every week to support our work, and we invite you to consider whether you might be able to make a pledge this time around. If you brought your pledges today, we're going to have a moment of dedication for your pledges later on in the service. If you're able, you can bring your pledges up here, leave them in the communion plates that we have, not communion plates, the offering plates that we have up here at the right time, or you can leave them, if you prefer, in the offering plates in the lobby as well, if that's easier for you. If you forgot your pledge form or haven't had a chance to fill one out, that's okay. Just bring it next week or drop it in the mail and send it to us. We also have an online form that you can fill out. Check out our webpage for that link. And if you are here online, you probably saw that big tree up on the wall in the lobby as you walked into the sanctuary. We're asking that you might also take a moment to write something on those hands that were distributed with our bulletins today, something that you want to contribute to God in this coming year, right? Something you want to give to God, either for the vitality of this church or for the strength of your neighborhood or for your families, for the health of those in your life. Take a moment, fill out a hand, and place it up there on the tree as you leave today. Help us fill out that tree as we close out our stewardship campaign this year. We believe that everyone has something to contribute. We all have something to share. Thank you for being part of this community of faith and for your faithful and generous support for our common work. We can't do any of this without you. A quick reminder as we move on in our announcements that we're always looking for help each and every Sunday to support community worship. We have opportunities every week to be a fellowship host, a greeter or a liturgist, and more. Please check the sign-up list by the church office if you're interested, or contact the church office and we will get you connected. Finally, I wanted to make mention, special mention, of these flowers this morning that are on our chancel, bringing beauty to our worship service today. These flowers are given in honor and memory of Peggy Hole and Chris Hole, by Mary Hole and their family. Peggy, as you probably saw, passed away on November 15th. Last year, a year ago tomorrow, and Chris died on November the 10th, 1980. We're grateful to God for their lives of faith, and their memories remain a blessing for all of us. Now that we're done with our announcements, we can get started. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I invite all of you who are able to stand in body or in spirit as together we read responsibly our call to worship. Let's pray together. To know the warmth of love, to have the assurance that someone cares, to be confident of our worth, to be bold to love in return, to be washed over with grace, to be accepted as we are, this is to know a bit of God. Then let us worship our God together. Amen. I invite all of you to join me in our first hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness.
Our liturgist today is Erin Gilmore. She will greet us and will lead us all in our prayer of confession today.
Good morning, Kirk. Good morning. Please join me in the prayer of confession, reflection, and renewal. Holy God, we open our hearts to you this day and offer the truth of our lives, that fear stifles us, the prejudice that binds us, the ignorance that hobbles us, the doubt that plagues us. Help us, we pray, that we will find courage in unlikely places, see the world with new and gracious eyes, move to those places where love is needed, and have faith that you are with us. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, I forgot. I have extra reading this week. Our righteousness is found in God, in Christ alone, a gift of God by faith. We seek God's way because it is just. We are convinced that when we seek God's way, there is forgiveness when we fall short. Beloved people of God, believe the good news of the gospel. In Christ, we are all forgiven. Please be seated.
Scripture passages for our reflection and meditation. This week, our first reading is from the prophet Isaiah, and Erin will lead us in that reading this morning.
As Chad mentioned, today's the first reading is from the prophet Isaiah. This is Isaiah 40, verses 28 through 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. God does not faint or grow weary. God's understanding is unsearchable. God gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I'm now glad to introduce our special music today. Today, Ethan Platt will sing Faithfulness, accompanied by Aaron Bates Kemp.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not, as thou hast been. now forever will be. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. As I have needed, thou hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine, 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Thanks, Ethan. That was extremely powerful and just lovely. Thank you for that. Our second reading today in this final stewardship sermon comes to us from the Epistle to the Ephesians. This is Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. I invite you to listen with me for God's word for us today. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know God, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which God has called you, what are the riches of God's glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of God's power for us who believe, according to the working of God's great power. God put this power to work in Christ when God raised him from the dead and seated him at God's right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And God has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is Christ's body, the fullness of him who fills all and all. And may God bless to us our reading and our understanding and our applying of this word to how we live our lives. Amen. So I don't quite know if this story is going to work, but I'm going to give it a go anyway. A few weeks ago, my wife, Brooke, sent me by text a link to an Instagram post that she saw. She doesn't do that very often. She's far more likely to send me funny TikToks of dogs being silly or something. I almost never get a Facebook or Instagram suggestion from her. But it was the 1st of November, and this was an Instagram post about Halloween the night before. The post was apparently making the rounds online. And her friends had liked and commented on it, which is how she saw it, and she thought that I'd like it. She told me that it might preach, which is something we preachers say when we see something that carries with it some deeper meaning, right? Something that will help commend the gospel in a sermon. This story, that news article, this commercial might be funny, might be serious, might be inspiring, might be able to say something about God. That'll preach, we would say. And Brooke thought that this Instagram post might fit that too somehow. All Brooke knew, I think, was that it was different, right? It got boosted by a few other Instagram accounts, which is how this works online. And this, these other Instagram accounts that post good-hearted material online, and this post was shared by Upworthy, right? Where it had received 471,000 likes on November the 4th, right? Just 3 days later, 471,000. And the funny thing is, I don't think Brooke was aware that I know the guy who made that original post on Instagram. His name is Matt Schultz. He's a pastor up in Anchorage. And Matt was talking about his amazing success on Halloween, handing out treats for all the trick-or-treaters. Matt clearly lives in a neighborhood with more children than the neighborhood we live in. We were delighted this year that we had 15, maybe 18 groups stop by, which is a lot for us. I think people were eager to get out this year, right? Because many people didn't get to go trick-or-treating last year with the pandemic and COVID and all that. And our neighborhood doesn't have a lot of kids in the first place. But it was great to see, for instance, our neighbor's son this year dressed from head to toe as their pet retriever. That was his costume this year. Some of the kids from next door as a baseball player and as a ninja. I mean, we love Halloween. And this year, like other years, we got all decorated. We put out pumpkins and on the porch, and we had some hay bales and cobwebs and all of that, lights on, bucket of bite-sized candy bars and Tootsie Rolls at the ready, and we wait to see if the kids are going to come by. And for many years, we just had a small handful, right? 3, 4, 5 groups of kids, if we're lucky. This year was better, meaning we had more kids. Less candy for me to eat after, but more kids. Now, we've heard, right, of people getting cute for Halloween, right, putting toothbrushes or dental floss or an apple, right, in their buckets. We always said, oh, goodness, they're going to get a trick this year for sure. And we didn't ever want to do that. We liked our house too much, wouldn't think of it. The kids, though, right, spend their whole year waiting for that one day where they get to go around as Woody from Toy Story and get a bucket full of candy. And so we surely were going to oblige. So when we saw Matt's post on Instagram, we were kind of shocked, to be honest. The post was a picture of his treat bucket, right? This orange wooden basket with black paint on the front to look like a jack-o'-lantern. And it's got all the staples in there, Snickers and Twix and Milk Duds. No Reese's, I noted. That's a major fail right there, Matt, my friend. And on top of that bucket, something was out of place. It was a potato. Yes, that's right, a potato. Let's see if I can get up on the screen. You can't read the words, but here's what Matt wrote. Tonight, kids chose potato more than 25 times. Each time, triumphantly proclaiming to family and friends, I got a potato. One kid shouted, a potato, just like last year. And another group said, oh, you're the potato house, you're legends. He continues, this has become an unexpected and joyful tradition. Kids are given the free choice, and over again, they choose potato. My friends, every day you are given a choice, I encourage you, choose potato. What do you think? Choose potato. Does that preach? Yeah, I'm with you. I don't know. Sounds a bit odd. I agree with you, but maybe I'll unpack it just a little bit. Sometimes, all it takes to make someone laugh, right, is to take the most ordinary of things and to put them to use in unexpected ways. I mean, that's really what most humor is, right? I mean, just ask my kids about those dad jokes I like to tell. I used to be addicted to soap, but I'm all clean now. Thank you. When does a dad joke become a dad joke? When it becomes apparent, right? Thank you. I ordered a chicken and an egg from Amazon. I'll let you know. But it's also true that, honestly, it doesn't take something extravagant, right, to make a difference, to make a connection. It doesn't take a lot. Sometimes something as mundane and as ordinary as a potato will do. I mean, on a night like Halloween with all the pageantry and hoopla, kids running from house to house with glow sticks, parents carefully watching from a few steps away, there's a routine, right, that gets going, right? You ring the doorbell, trick or treat. Oh, hey there, what are you supposed to be? A rocket ship, a football player, a ghost, a gumball machine. Mitch, that's for you. Here, have some candy. Have fun. Enjoy your neighborhood, your childhood. Know that we care about you. And we wave at the parents as they walk onto the next porch. And my friend Matt offered all that too, right? You saw the candy basket for the kids in his neighborhood. But Matt also added something unexpected, something earthy, something simple. It was a raw potato. It gave the kids a different kind of choice. And 25 kids apparently decided that they wanted that this year because it was different, because it was a potato. Kids love potatoes. Goodness, I love potatoes, particularly mashed potatoes. I mean, I don't know when Matt started offering potatoes on Halloween, but by now it's a tradition for him. And Matt has taken that enough, to post it online, which isn't his normal kind of social media post at all. He's usually talking about homelessness in Anchorage, but that post of his was liked by almost 500,000 people. People who went and checked him out, you know, got to know him, got to know a little bit of his work, and it was shared on dozens and dozens of other platforms, all because of a simple, silly, ordinary, inexpensive idea. When you're given a choice, whenever you can, choose potato. Happy Halloween. One of the things that has been impacting the church recently is a fear about sustainability. Do we have enough? Enough people, enough resources, enough time, enough energy? To which I say, yes, yes, we do, right? Each and every gift is needed and necessary and so very appreciated. And your gift, my friends, is more appreciated than we could ever adequately express. But sometimes we get so focused on those questions and are worried by them that we don't think about other questions, important questions. Do we have enough creativity? Do we have enough compassion? Do we have enough faithfulness? Do we have enough love? And those are the stuff of sustainability too, at least they are for a church. And those are the questions that honestly should guide every church, every community that seeks to follow God on the way of Jesus Christ. Our session, my friends, have been reading a book together this year called Quietly Courageous, Leading the Church in a Changing World. And the author, Gil Rendell, argues that we have all been grounded in an understanding of church that was formed in the 1950s and 1960s, right after the Second World War, which was a time of unprecedented output in this country. Lots of churches grew as suburbs grew when there was this societal pressure to be part of church, right? And many of those churches did big and good things, but they sought to focus on bigger, glitzier, more. And it was not a normal time because those decades of unusual growth. But because of that, we keep judging ourselves based on that period rather than on this one that we're living in. And it's really very tempting to fret that we're not living up to the way the things were instead of asking ourselves if we're focused on the right things, if we have enough of those things for God's purpose for us today. Do we have enough creativity? Do we have enough compassion? Do we have enough faithfulness? Do we have enough love? And when we're stuck in those older model of things, we get wrapped up in fear and anxiety and worry until those things It's so simple, really. It's genius. Who doesn't love a good potato? It doesn't cost all that much. I mean, it's cheaper than candy, that's for sure. And somehow, it lights up those kids more than the Snickers and the Twix. I mean, they wanted candy, too, I'm sure, from all the other stops. But Matt found a way to be different, to connect, without getting the most expensive candy. Just by doing things a little bit special, trying to connect with the kids that came to him in a different sort of way. And I wonder, what could we, good church, learn from that? Maybe we could see that it doesn't take much to connect with our neighbors, that it doesn't take much to try to bring joy and happiness to others. Just a wee bit of creativity and a willingness to give it a try. Some of the most powerful passages of Scripture are those that commend an alternative to this fretting about whether we will have enough. I mean, how many times does Jesus talk about money, about food, about work, about enough? And Jesus answers in parables about the God of generous abundance, the God of prodigal, prodigious love. In all of those moments, the Bible talks about hope, a sense of trust about the future, God's future, and an invitation to join God on the journey to get there. The reading we just offered from the letter to the Ephesians is a good example of this. The author offers a word of greeting to that church in Ephesus, noting how he has heard of their faith and their love, which rouses within them a sense of thanksgiving. And I wonder, did you hear what he said about hope, about the importance of hope for this community of faith? I remember you in my prayers, he writes. I pray that you will have a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know Christ Jesus, that you might know the hope to which you are called, which are the riches of God's glorious inheritance, the immeasurable greatness of his power for those of us who believe it. Hope is the currency of the faithful, Ephesians suggests. And we hear these words like immeasurably great and powerful and glorious inheritance, the hope to which you are called. A hope that we find in Jesus Christ, whom God has placed over all things, a sign that in the end, God's plan will win, that love is more powerful than hate, that life will triumph over death, that we have a part to play in supporting that plan, God's very own world on earth. Hope is the currency of the faithful. And hope is grounded in a sense of trust in what God is doing all around us, here, and where we follow where God leads us, believing that there are good days ahead. Honestly, this is one of my favorite Sundays of the church year. It's not officially on any liturgical calendar, but Stewardship Dedication Sunday has always been a joy. Today we celebrate what is life-giving, joy-seeking, forgiveness-making, love-building about this place, about the Kirk. Every good deed that we do together, every prayer that we offer for one another, every expression of support that we can muster and welcome, that we can extend. Today, we lift up where our heart is, the hope that we have, because God is our God. And we are God's people, learning how to follow God because of Jesus Christ. Today is a celebration of what it means to be church, what it means to be community, this work of reconciliation that we have been given, what it means for us to live into the story of God's great love, God's triumph in our life, this life over death, trust over fear. More than ever, this world of ours needs the kind of community that a church like the Kirk can offer. Have you felt that? As you watch the news, as you talk to your neighbor, as you watch how people act towards each other? I truly believe it. A church that affirms there is enough creativity, there is enough compassion, there is enough faithfulness, enough hope to Because God is here. And we respond to God with thanksgiving, with a desire to follow where she will lead us. It doesn't have to be grand. It doesn't have to be glitzy. It just has to be true. Genuine. Authentic. Faithful. To those people who wait for the Lord, people like us, Isaiah tells us we will find our strength renewed, our spirits enlivened, our hopes confirmed. We've been seeking to be this sort of church for 60-odd years. And with God's help, we'll be doing that for many, many, many more. So may we continue to look forward, trusting that God's good gifts for us are sufficient to be the church God wants us to be. And may we welcome everyone to experience God's love as we seek to be God's church here today. My friends, may it be so. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Every week we pause for a moment of gratitude to acknowledge God as the one from whom all blessings flow, where we pledge to use the gifts God lovingly gives us to a good purpose. To be able to live our lives with thanksgiving as our first impulse, this is a foundation of a joyful heart, and allows us to truly cultivate a generous and a giving spirit. In this, we not only imitate our God, but we make it possible for others to live better, more full, more faithful lives. Today is Pledge Dedication Sunday. For those of you who are ready, as we sing our response, I invite you to bring forward your pledges for this year as we sing this stewardship song. If you are not inclined to get up and come forward, that's okay. You can just leave it in the basket as you leave. Whether you're dedicating your pledge today or submitting it a bit later, we all give thanks today for the ministry of the Kirk of Kansas City. So let's sing our response together as we invite those who wish to bring their pledges to bring them forward. Let's sing together.
So God.
thanksgiving, and dedication with the words that are on the screen. Gracious God, you will give us life. You are the source of every blessing. These offerings are but a token of our gratitude to you. Use them and use us to work with your will in this world you love. And let us always say and be to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Can I just say you guys sing really well? Friends, now we're going to move to our time of community prayer. And I'm going to lift up some prayer concerns that are common and specific to our church community. If you're watching with us online and you don't know these people personally, that's okay. Just send your best thoughts along anyway. And if you are watching and wish to share your prayer requests, now is a good time to do that. We'll take them all together and we'll wrap them up in our prayers today as well. At the end of each of our petitions, we'll complete the words, O Lord, hear our prayer. You can say that with me. O Lord. Hear our prayers. We begin our prayers today. We have for now 20 months with prayers about our ongoing struggle against COVID-19, for those who have died both here and abroad, and for those who continue with the lasting impacts of the disease. We pray for families and for loved ones, for healthcare workers, and everyone who seeks to build healthy, strong, coronavirus-free communities. O Lord, hear our prayers. We also pray today for this ongoing struggle against systemic racism as we seek to do our part to end racism in our lives and in the country. We ask God to help us claim this work as our very own as we join with all others who follow Jesus Christ and those of goodwill to seek to love our neighbor as ourselves. O Lord, hear our prayers. We pray today for Martha Moss. Martha died a week ago on Saturday, and a service of witness to the resurrection was held on Friday this week at Muehlbach. We lift her up, as well as Martha's family in prayer, and all of those who will miss her. We pray that her memory may be a blessing for all of us. O Lord, hear our prayers. We also lift up today with prayer Dana McEachin. Dana is currently in critical ICU care at St. Luke's Hospital after surgeries this week to attend to bleeding on her brain. We pray today for her health and for her comfort. We pray for Neil and for Hunter and for Nina. We pray for Phil and Leslie Youngs as they seek to care for her. O Lord, hear our prayers. We lift up today Jennifer Beckley's mother-in-law, Brenda Beckley. Brenda is undergoing medical tests. We offer prayers for her comfort and prayers for some clarity. O Lord, hear our prayers. We share a prayer of joy this morning. Today at First Presbyterian Church of Kirkwood, Missouri, that's a suburb of St. Louis, Lillian Grace Hathorn is going to be baptized. She might already be baptized by now. We celebrate along with her parents, Adam and Grace Hathorn, as well as proud grandparents, Brian and Betty Hathorn. O Lord, hear our prayers. Cheryl Keimig lifts up prayers for her dear friend Peggy, whose husband died yesterday morning after a brief stay in home hospice. Prayers for the entire Poppy family. O Lord, hear our prayers. Offer a prayer of thanksgiving from John Tucker. Georgia is doing well after her surgery this week. She offers gratitude for all the cards and prayers. O Lord, hear our prayers. And Sandy Williams also offers a prayer of gratitude. She says, thanks so much for your continued prayers for my friend Stephanie Peterson and her family. Stephanie is finally off the vent. Her family gets to visit her tomorrow. Praise the Lord. Continued prayers for her full recovery. O Lord, hear our prayers. And also from Sandy, another co-worker and her husband were admitted to the hospital yesterday for COVID. We offer prayers today for the Floyd family. O Lord, hear our prayers. We also lift up others who have been regular people in our prayer life as a Kirk. Prayers for Bob Melton, Linda Masood, Michael Lyons, Whitney Lucas Claycamp, Betty Price, Betty Vos, Betty Slusher, Gloria McDonald, Norina Curso, Wendy Nielsen, Francis Dean, Ralph and Eileen Mitchell, Marjorie Langford, Rachel Smith, Don Daniels, Quindy Veach, Bill and Larry Neal, Donald Rosberg, Kate Schaefer, the people of the Cameroon. Today we also pray for this Kirk, that God will knit us together as God intends us to be knit together. O Lord, hear our prayer. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, on this day of rest and gladness, we stop and wait and look and wonder. Thank you for your presence in our lives, in this community, in this very room. Thank you for calling us to be your people. We offer you today our prayers, these words of concern for loved ones and for the world. And we are grateful that you hear them and you shape them and you use them for our good. We pray for those near to us, loved ones, family, friends, neighbors. We lift up to you our concerns about their well-being, their burdens and their health, their dreams and their weariness. We particularly pray for our neighbors who struggle to have enough food to eat, safe place to rest their head at night, access to good medical care and clothing. And we pray for those around us who need your presence as they seek wholeness of body or mind or spirit. Those who are beset with a host of medical concerns from heart disease to diabetes to cancer to Parkinson's. We lift up those who are living with HIV/AIDS, for those with dementia and their caregivers, for everyone who wrestles with mental illness. Send your strength to be with us, we pray. Where healing is possible, we ask it. And in all things, help us to rest our finite bodies in your infinite love. We pray today for our community and for the world. We lift up our struggle against COVID and lift up those who work so hard to stand in the gap to mend communities together. We pray for those who mourn, those who have died, those with long-lasting illness, and we continue to pray for those who endure natural disaster, hurricane, wildfire, climate change. Help us tend to the needs of those in harm's way. And above all, we pray for peace, peace in the world, peace in our land, peace in our homes. Help us to strive, as Jesus did, for peace and healing, justice and reconciliation for all. As our Lord taught us, we pray for anyone who wishes to do us harm. In your love and in your wisdom, guide us, we pray, O Prince of Peace. We thank you for this Kirk, for these people, for this love, for this purpose you give us. Empower us to be more faithful day after day. And we wrap up today our prayers in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as we say together the prayer that he taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As you are able, I invite you to stand again in body or in spirit as we sing our final hymn, Though I May Speak. Friends, God has claimed us, claimed you and me, part of God's community, part of the realm of God. What an amazing and awesome and exciting calling that is. And now we prepare to look ahead to God's new day with purpose, sharing God's love and God's compassion, God's very own agents in the world. As you look around, you'll see others living into this reality. So too, it is for us this Lord's Day. We proclaim Christ is alive. Something new is afoot. God gives us hope, even during days such as this. And so we take up our work with hope and with faith and with thanksgiving. Now, go out in the world in peace. Have courage. Hold fast to what is good. Return no one, evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord your God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be yours forever and ever. Amen. Amen.